You and your friends are choosing a vacation spot, either a beach, city, or mountains. You each rank the options, and now you need to decide where to go based on the rankings. Seems straightforward, right? Actually, we can prove there is no perfectly rational way to do this. No matter what method we use, there's always a possibility of a flawed group decision. Let's explore the surprising result known as Arrow's Impossibility Theorem. This video is sponsored by Squarespace, an all-in-one solution that makes it easy for you to build your website or online store and succeed online. Our goal is to find a social welfare function, a function that takes each person's ordered preferences as the inputs and outputs a complete transitive preference order for the group. We want our voting system to be fair and rational, so we'll impose four key conditions. The first requirement is that our function must work for any possible set of individual rankings, no matter how contradictory or unusual they may be. The second requirement is our rule cannot be a dictatorship. No one person can determine the entire outcome. The third requirement is that if everyone unanimously prefers A to B, then A should beat B in the group's ordering. The last requirement is known as independence of irrelevant alternatives. The group's preference between A and B should only depend on how everyone ranked A and B, and it should not depend on other alternatives. It's like if the group decides to go to the beach, but when one of them suggests climbing a volcano as a possibility, suddenly everyone agrees to go to the mountains. It doesn't make sense for the new volcano option to switch the group's preference for the beach over the mountains. If there are at least three alternatives, then Arrow's Impossibility Theorem tells us that there is no social welfare function that satisfies all these properties. For example, we might try a plurality method where we only count everyone's first place votes and we ignore all the other rankings. Consider these rankings. With plurality voting, beach will win with three votes compared to two for city and two for mountains. But what happens if suddenly the city is no longer a possibility? Once city is removed, now mountains are the first choice of four out of the seven people. By removing the city, the group's preference for the mountains and the beach have swapped. So plurality voting violates the independence of irrelevant alternatives. And Arrow's theorem tells us this isn't just a problem with plurality voting. Any other voting system that we construct is going to have similar issues. Just like Arrow's theorem reveals hidden complexities in decision-making, building a website has its hidden challenges. Handling databases, optimizing performance, it can get overwhelming. But with Squarespace, you don't need to worry about any of that. Squarespace combines decades of design experience with powerful new AI tools in their design intelligence, so anyone can build a beautiful, responsive, custom website fast. Need to book clients for consulting or tutoring? Squarespace's Acuity scheduling makes it easy to manage appointments, accept payments, and send automated reminders, all in one place. Plus, Squarespace's email campaigns make it easy to stay connected with your audience, whether you're promoting services or sharing updates. Squarespace takes care of all the technical details so you can focus on your content. Head to squarespace.com to get your free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/drshawn to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Now, let's get back to the proof of Arrow's Impossibility Theorem. The main idea is a decisive coalition. A coalition is any group of individuals. A coalition is called decisive for AB if, when everyone in the coalition ranks A above B, then the group overall will rank A above B. If a coalition is decisive for all pairs, then we just call it decisive. Intuitively, this means the coalition has the power to decide the outcome as long as they all vote unanimously. A coalition being decisive for AB is a pretty strong condition. If the coalition ranks A above B, then A will beat B, no matter how everyone else ranks the alternatives. To help us in our proof, we'll introduce one more idea, weakly decisive. A coalition is weakly decisive for AB if whenever everyone in the coalition ranks A above B, and everyone outside the coalition ranks B above A, then A will beat B in the group's rankings. We can think of this as like the worst case scenario from the coalition's perspective. everyone outside the coalition ranked B above A. This condition will be easier for us to use in the proof since we'll know exactly what situation we need to check. Step one is this lemma. If a coalition G is weakly decisive for AB, then in fact, it is decisive. We start with the coalition G, which is weakly decisive for AB. We'd like to show that G is decisive for AC for any alternative C. Say everyone in the coalition votes for A over C. By the independence of irrelevant alternatives, the preferences for B have nothing to do with the comparison between A and C. So let's say in the coalition G, everybody's rankings go A, B, C. Outside of G, let's say B ranks higher than A and also higher than C. The position of B in the rankings is irrelevant for comparing A and C, so we're allowed to assume this case. Now, everyone prefers B to C, so B will rank higher than C in the group's order. And we know that A ranks higher than B because the coalition is weakly decisive for AB. So A is higher than B, and B is higher than C, and so A is higher than C. As long as the coalition unanimously prefers A to C, then A will rank higher than C in our social welfare function. We can repeat this proof to show that G is decisive for C over B. Since C was an arbitrary alternative, this same argument shows that G is decisive for any pair. This means that G is a decisive coalition. Now there's just one step left. Let's start with the decisive coalition G of at least two people. We know there's at least one, which is the entire group. Now let's split the coalition into two non-empty subsets, G1 and G2. It doesn't matter how we split it, as long as G1 and G2 both have at least one person. Now consider what happens if everyone votes this way. Everyone in G1 ranks A, B, C. Everyone in G2 ranks C, A, B. And those who were not in the original coalition rank B, C, A. Now note that last group might be nobody, and that's okay, but G1 and G2 have at least one person each. Since everyone in the decisive coalition ranks A above B, then A will beat B in the group's order. So there are three possible positions where C can go. In each of these cases, either A is above C or C is above B, or both. Let's consider these cases one at a time. If A is above C, then let's check what's happening with G1. In G1, everyone ranked A above C. Notice that the other two groups ranked A and C the opposite way, C over A. So this means G1 is weakly decisive for AC. But then by our lemma, G1 is a decisive coalition for all pairings. The other case is if C beats B. Now let's look at G2. In G2, everyone voted for C over B, and in the other two groups, they ranked B over C. So this is the definition of G2 being weakly decisive for CB. And then again, we apply our lemma to see that G2 would be a decisive coalition in this case. So at least one of G1 and G2 must be a decisive coalition. Given any decisive coalition of at least two people, we can split it into two smaller groups, and at least one of those groups is still a decisive coalition. We can repeat this until we have a decisive coalition with exactly one person. If there's a decisive coalition with exactly one person, it means that person's rankings determine the rankings for the group. So that person is a dictator. This violates our conditions, so the proof is complete. Arrow's theorem has profound implications for any decision-making process involving rankings, from economics and politics to algorithms and artificial intelligence. Methods like ranked choice voting attempt to mitigate these limitations, but all of these methods are still subject to Arrow's theorem, and no ranked voting system can escape these limitations. But it's also important to remember that Arrow's theorem doesn't say how often a voting method will be irrational. Some may fail less often than others. And Arrow's theorem doesn't apply to other types of voting, like if everyone gives a numerical score to each alternative. Let us know your thoughts about Arrow's theorem in the comments. Subscribe for more videos like this one, and I'll see you next time.